It was a dark and stormy night. Well, actually, it really was a dark and stormy night. We left Bermuda on Sunday to sail in a 42-foot sailboat across the Atlantic Ocean 600 miles. Now, it had been predicted that there was not going to be any wind for 5 days. Now, I had not flown to Bermuda in order to power 600 miles across the Atlantic. So what I did is I went down to the dock where everyone was getting ready to take this trip, and I said, come on, everyone, think wind. Come on, everyone, think wind. We'll have a great sail home. Well, after 2 days of dead flat calm, I got my wish. And I was on watch with my watchmate, Mark, and I've been watching the clouds as they've been building and we're having a better and better time. And I noticed that a squall had developed. And I said, Mark, look at that. I said, we got a squall coming. Looks like we got about, I don't know, about 25, 30 knots worth of wind. It's going to be here in about, I don't know, I'd say about 40 minutes. You want to reef the sails? Reefing the sails is when you make them smaller, so when the big wind gets, right, you don't heel over quite so far and everyone can stay safe. So he just looked at me. You see, when I had gotten on board, Mark told me that he didn't like women at sea. Mark had said, when I was on watch with him, I couldn't speak. Now that meant that whether I was on deck or down below, I had to be silent because everyone was asleep down below. And I thought, phew, this is going to be a long 6 days for me. So I said to him, I said, Mark, are you sure that you don't want to reef the sails now? He just looked at me. I said, okay, you take the helm. I'm off watch. I'm going below to go to bed. So I'm just dozing off about 40 minutes later, get some shut-eye when all hell breaks loose. All hands on deck, all hands on deck, the captain's crying, right? Mark, the captain's at the helm now, Mark's down below, digging through, trying to find the smaller sail to put up on the front of the boat. And we're in our foul weather gear. And you know, after about an hour, hour and a half, everybody knows what they're doing, so we're fine, right? Well, the next day, you know, the wind had calmed down, of course, and so we have the sails back up, and lo and behold, I'm on watch. Wow, Mark, we got a second squall. Do you want to reef the sails now? I mean, it looks like we got about 30, 35 knots now, and I don't know, we only have about, I don't know, maybe a half an hour to get ready. What do you think you said?
No.
Right, he wasn't interested. He just, well, you can guess what happened. After about 30 minutes, we had an all hands on deck again. Now, I want to let you know that by the third squall, we were ready. We were prepared. And I'm on the helm, and he looks at me and he goes, how do you do that? Well, how I do that is that I am talented with the ability to be able to make the complex simple. You see, we all come into this world complete, exactly as you are. You have your talents, your abilities, and your gifts, the very essence of who you are. You have your feelings that are like your GPS that tell you exactly where you are and where you want to go. And you have your body, which is your satellite dish to the world. It beams into you information, and you beam that information back out. And my talent to make the complex simple, I have used as the owner of my sailing school on the Hudson River. And I had taken a course at Nori Point State Park on how to tell weather, to understand weather. And the teacher had taught me some ways of knowing about the wind, you know, and the atmospheric pressure and all those kinds of things. And you know, it really is, you know, Doppler radar weather on the ones every 10 minutes, right? Makes it feel very complicated and we can't figure it out. But I was able to take the wisdom and the knowledge that he had given me in a 2-hour sailing course, and then this fabulous book called Weather Wisdom. It gives you all the compilations over the years of things that we've gathered as farmers and is looking at the environment of how things work in the weather and to be able to know when it was going to rain and when we needed to plant our crops. It was just very simple, straightforward stuff, which is up my alley. I love it simple and straightforward. For instance, I was on my way home from Orlando the other day, back to my home on the East Coast, and the cows were lying down in the field. Now, the cows lie down in the field before rain because they want a nice dry spot, right? And so they were all laid down. I said, oh, that's interesting. And by the time I get home, it was raining. So by taking all these different ideas and putting them together, and as I sailed the Hudson, as I was teaching my students, I watched. I go, oh, that plus that, ah, how that happened. Oh, and this plus that, that didn't happen. Ah. And I started, and I was able to not only do that with weather, but also do that with sailing. So in 5 2-hour lessons, my students were able to charter in the Caribbean and know exactly when to reef their sails. And I have all my life wanted to make the complex simple. It never made sense, even as a child, that things were just, that the world was too complicated. I had siblings that were 10, 8, and 5 years older than me. And I would watch them fighting and talking about stuff, and I'd go, I don't get it. It just can't be this complicated. I would go to the woods, play in my caves, and, you know, back then, you know, cowboys and Indians, and I'd be the cowboy, and I'd be the Indian, you know, and having a great time out there. But, and I always just wanted to find people that could make this universe understandable. And in my 20s, I met a woman named Patricia Sun. And Patricia Sun was the first person that I met. Oh, that's how it works. I knew it could be simple. And she explained relationships in a way far beyond Mars and Venus. She understood the brain and how the hemispheres of the brain worked way back then, when I was in my 20s, before it was being taught other places that we understand today. She's been on stages with Deepak Chopra and Marianne Williamson and Wayne Dyer, and she understood it, and I went, oh, yes, I get it. And then recently, I met a man named Luis Garcia, and Luis and I have been working together intimately for seven years, working. I've edited 4 of his books, and we've been working, and he's helped me to understand the quantum physics, the science of emotions. And there again, I went, yes, I knew it had to be simple. And that's what I want to share with you today, some of these concepts, some of these ideas. And I want you to do one thing for me today. I want you to be willing to be willing. I want you to be willing to be willing to see things differently. I want you to be willing to go with the flow of my process and just allow it to happen, and then you take what you want and leave the rest. Because at times you're going to feel like I'm asking you to walk on your hands. And I promise you that at the end you're going to jump in for joy, back on your feet, and going, this is simple. And what I'd love to do is to be able to share this knowledge with you. I'm so grateful to be here. Because, you know, everything is an evolution, isn't it? Everything evolves. You know, for millions of years we thought that the world was flat, right? We thought that if we went to the edge, we drop off. And what we discovered is one man was bold, courageous, determined, that if he went to the edge, there'd be another edge, and another edge, and another edge. And we just celebrated Columbus Day. And that's where I feel we are when we die, is we're just on the edge of discovering a new idea, a new concept that I want to share with you. You know, I watch TED Talks, Technology, Education, Design. How many people watch TED Talks? Ah, we got the right crowd here. I watch it every single night, 1 or 2 videos. And there was a talk, and the researcher was saying, do you see that cell up there? Do you see that little piece right there? He said, you know, we thought that was useless, and we're discovering that that might have the cure for cancer. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm going to share with you about our emotions and how parts that we have thought were want to get rid of, avoid, are not there for that reason at all. And, you know, Dr. Boyatitz, I've studied with at Case Western University, and he's done many research projects with Daniel Goldman. And he was saying the other day on a video, he said, you know, when we see things just this way, if we saw things just that way, that angle can make the difference between being useful and not. And I come to my knowledge of understanding about procrastination and how to kiss it goodbye from studying so closely, so intimately, that I feel like I got my PhD in it. Because I studied it from every angle. You see, I went from being worth over $1 million to having $7 in my bank account 3 weeks before Christmas. You see, the shame about procrastination is not just that we're not picking up the phone and doing our follow-up calls, that we're not doing our marketing to move our business forward, that we're breaking promises to our family and to ourselves, is that we're not actualizing who we are. We're not developing who we are and developing the talents, gifts, and abilities that we need to be able to effectively move forward in our life and to develop all of who we are. And so what happened was is that I had been a very successful yacht broker in Annapolis, Maryland. I was the second highest yacht broker in my company. So I thought I would just go on down to Miami and I would sell those big boats, those multi-million dollar, $8 million, $13 million boats. And I got down there and I was an abject failure. I sold 3 boats in 2 years and they were little ones. In Annapolis, I sold 10 boats in 2 months. And so it broke my confidence. I started to doubt myself. I started to not believe in who I was. I started to doubt my intuition, which is the very essence of who we are as well. And when I did that, I started to make one decision after another. And the way I did it is I threw money at it. I spent money on this program and that program, this networking company and that, this thing that was going to make me $1 million in a minute. Because I wanted to prove to myself and to my family that I was okay, that I could do it, that I could get those millions back. But I wasn't okay. I wasn't okay. I felt insecure, not good enough, never going to make it, inadequate. And I was running from that, and running from that every day, and how I filled that emptiness was with money. If I could just throw enough money at it, something was going to stick. But it didn't, and it wasn't until the day that I had a real estate coach that was supposed to help me around 2008, right? 2008, the crash, right? And I was gonna sell those short sales, I was gonna be a millionaire, I bought this very expensive program that was gonna teach me. And I'd done real estate, done really well, so I thought, oh, I could do that. And so I was waiting for her to call me because I couldn't get the program to work. And I had to get the program to work in order to type up the material, to fax it off, to get them, so I could get money, and I had to have money. I didn't have money, I needed money. And so I waited and waited for the call. And the phone never rang. And I felt embarrassed and humiliated and not good enough. I felt like I didn't count, I didn't matter. I didn't even matter enough for her, to pick up the phone. And so I started to cry, the dam broke. And I started to cry, and for 23 hours, I cried. I felt like I was in the ring with Muhammad Ali. Every time I got up and pulled myself together, like my mother told me, now pull yourself together. Now just keep working on it. You can do it. You'll be all right. I'd pull myself together and then I felt like I'd been punched because there I'd be on the ground again crying. And in a moment of calm, I had an idea. I said, I'll call Ken. He's a Mac specialist. Maybe he'll know how to get this program to work. So I called Ken and he said, Marty, put a dash between John and Matthews. It worked. The program worked. I typed it up, I got in the car, drove to mailman Joey, Brian faxed it off, and on my way home, I got it. I said, you're not being of integrity with who you are. You're not doing what you were put on this planet to do. You have not lived in your passion. See, what Mark Twain said, is he said there's two important days in your life. The day you're born and the day you know life. And so what I did is I got home and I closed 4 of the 5 companies that I was running. It's hard to believe, but I was working 14, 18 hours a day, going nowhere. And I closed 4 of my 5 companies. I kept my coaching business because that's who I am. I mean, at 5, I was organizing the playground. By 6th grade, I was called Mom, because I was giving out so much advice. And I went downstairs and I did what I had denied myself for 13 years. I started to write. See, what had happened is I'd written my book on sailing for women, called Just the Basics. And I had a really reputable company that was going to publish it, and then a glitch happened, and it didn't get published. And it broke my heart. And I put it in a box, and I put it up on the shelf, and I didn't touch it again. By unlocking my creative potential, I sat there that day and I wrote for 12 hours. I looked up and I went, oh, it's dark. And I looked at the clock and it was midnight. And by unlocking my creative potential, I began to be able to put the pieces together to understand procrastination and to develop my KISS procrastination device system. Because that's one of the crucial pieces for each and every one of you, is to look at where you are not using your creative potential. Where are you holding down that creative potential and not using it? And so there's a good reason that we do that to ourselves. It's a good reason that we have learned how to do that. What happens is that when we're children, we might do something, you know, we're just these wonderful creatures that are just going to be spontaneous, and we've got all this creativity going on, and we just want to express it, and we go, Mommy, Mommy, look at my picture, look at my picture. Put it up on the fridge. Put it on the fridge. I got to cook dinner. And the mom starts cooking dinner. And she doesn't really notice it's not up in the fridge. But she goes to go take out the garbage before she calls the children down. And there, on top of the garbage, is the picture. And the child might think, I thought I was an artist, but I guess I'm not. I thought I was lovable. Guess not. I thought I was an artist. I'm not. Or you could be like the woman who at about 54 years old, I heard her sing. And I said, Susie, why don't you sing louder? I mean, I hear your voice, but it doesn't stand out in the choir, you know, and you have such a beautiful voice. And she said to me, well, Marty, when I was about 10 years old, Mom and Dad got divorced. And we had to go live in a very small apartment with my aunt and my uncle. And what happened is that I used to sit out on the step waiting for the school bus to come. And I would sing, and I just loved to sing. And so in about 2 months, we were thrown out of the apartment. And I said, Mom, why are we thrown out? And she said, I told you not to sing so loud. 40 some odd years later, she's still not singing loud. And that's what we do. And so what I say is that this is what we look like inside. We look like we have swish cheese holes. This is our emptiness that we seek to fill every day. We look to fill our emptiness with everything outside of ourselves. Until we understand emotional intelligence, we fill it with everything outside of ourselves. So for some people, this might be an option, right? You got a tough day at work, on your way home, this might be an option. When you're really desperate, right? Pull out the chocolate. For others, it might be love. Most of the time, it's broken love. And we chase one person after another, saying, if they will only love me, if they will only tell me that they love me, I'll be okay. I'll know that I'm valuable. And we chase one person after the other, after the other, into the hole. For me, money, right? Good money. After good money, after good money. And it's all falling on the ground, isn't it? And that's what happens for us. It doesn't ever fill our emptiness. When we look to fill our emptiness from the outside in, applause. I wanted applause. I was going to be one of those people in the network marketing company that was going to be diamond. And I was going to get applause and be told how wonderful I was and what a fabulous leader I was. And I am all that. but I didn't have the emotional intelligence to be able to do it in a way that it wasn't for that, but it was for something else. So when we do it for something else, what happens is there you are, you have 7 gold medals, and you're standing and the anthem is playing, and you're thinking, why didn't I get the 7th medal? Why did I not do good enough, right? If we're doing it for something other than, I love the way I jumped over the fences, I love the way I swam in the pool, I love the way my body felt. When it's about us, it fills us up. When it's for the applause, it never fills us. And so this is what happens. Now those feelings that I've been talking about, those feelings of, you know, not good enough, never gonna make it, we've all been running from. We've all been told our whole life the myth that some feelings are good and some feelings are bad. And the reason it's a myth, you see, is that I want you to think about a creator. I want you to think about creating something and on purpose putting something in it that was useless, something that you wanted to avoid. You know, let's say you hired an architect and you want to design your beautiful new home. And you'd want this beautiful bathroom, you know, about $20,000, the marble, the view of the backyard. And when the architect is done, that can you imagine that if he, on purpose, put in plumbing that didn't work, that it was useless, he on purpose did that. And that the day you walk into your new home, you're so proud, and the first thing you do is you walk over and you put yellow tape across the door with a sign that says, avoid at all costs. Now, would any creator do that? No. You know what? Ours didn't either. Ours didn't either. There is nothing inside of us that we made to avoid. We came incomplete exactly as we are. And your feelings are nothing more than information. If I walked over to the light switch, feeling, the information would up to the light, on. That's it. That's a feeling. And so I'm going to show you the science of a feeling. I'm going to show you how our feelings actually work. Oh, that's me. And this is true. Discovering is seeing what never has seen and thinking what has never been thought. And that's what we're going to be doing. So here we are with my feeling guy, right? And right here is where your feelings are born. This is where, from your creativity source, your source of information. You see, this is one of those walking hand moments, on their hand moments. Some of you may know this. But you feel, therefore you think. You feel, therefore you think. You do not think, therefore you feel. You feel, therefore you think. You do not think, therefore you feel. Baby comes out. Right? There it is. And it feels uncomfortable. In your flyers, you will see this. So you can open your flyer and you'll see the next part of the presentation. So the baby comes out and it feels uncomfortable. Oh, wait. Right? Give the baby the bottle. A little while later, oh, made a mess. Oh, uncomfortable. Wah. The baby feels, then it thinks, and then it starts to crawl, then it starts to walk. It's an evolution. So you feel, therefore you think. And what happens is we have a feeling, not good enough, never going to make it, lonely, depressed, lost, angry, resentful, rageful. And what we do is we have our solar plexus right here. Now this is your command center, right here. You've all experienced it, right? And your command center either allows you to feel or it doesn't. And it's your friend, it's your body, your body's your friend. So it says, oh, Marty, you don't want to feel inadequate? Not good enough? No problem, I'll shut down. And this is when we get that stomach ache. We're like, oh, I wish this pain would go away, right? And so when we do that and we shut our solar plexus down, your feelings had information for you to tell you about how, where you were not good enough that day, and what you have done is their friend shows up and you don't want to hear it. And you say, I don't want to know. And so what happens is that there's only one place that that can go, and that's up to our limbic brain. Our limbic brain that you've heard about this weekend, our limbic brain and back where your reptilian brain is. Your reptilian brain is the one that keeps your heart pumping and everything going on. You don't have to think about it right now, everything works. And that limbic brain is your emotional brain, fight or flight, fight or flight. I want you to be in about third grade when you saw some pictures of the cavemen, Neanderthal guys, right? They had no frontal lobe. They had no frontal lobe here to process information. And so back then, the caveman would see the big thing, run, see the big thing, run, see the big thing, run, see the big thing. They couldn't put together that what the poop on the ground meant that big thing lived here and they better go on another trail. They didn't have the mental capacity to do that, so they kept repeating what they knew. Who here has seen Groundhog Day, the movie Groundhog Day? A beautiful metaphor for what we do to ourselves when we're in that limbic brain, repeating over and over again what we need to learn, right? The universe keeps giving us lessons until we get it. Just like Phil the weatherman kept having to learn the lesson that being inauthentic and not real was not going to get him to the next day. It was only when Phil the weatherman allowed himself to feel and to be real and authentic did the day move forward. And so that's what we do to ourselves. And for us, when we're in our limbic brain, what happens is we go to not good enough, not good enough, not good enough. When we're in our limbic brain, we run from ourselves, and all we can remember is our failures, where we didn't make it. For me, that meant more money. For someone, it might mean more food or more booze or whatever is your choice of outside to fill that emptiness. And we always are judging ourselves from not good enough, not good enough, not good enough. But when we allow our command center to open up and to allow that feeling to come from our gut, it goes to our heart, it goes to our frontal lobe, and then it goes back to our limbic brain. When we decode the feelings, which we're going to do in a moment, when we decode our feeling and know the information that is there for us, we come from good enough, good enough, good enough. And that's what we're going to do this morning, is take EI to the next level. To take it from controlling and managing your emotions and picking the next one, to being able to decode the information that has been given to us, to understand exactly what's going on. And so you'll see in your brochure that after the little guys, you've got in the center, you have I want you to find a partner. Just turn to your right or your left, because I only have a few minutes here. Just turn to your right or to your left. Or behind or in front.
This is my first time seeing it.
Okay, so the person with the shortest hair, raise your hand. Of the couple, the person with the shortest hair, raise your hand. Do you have more brochures? Of 10 people right here. Okay, I need your attention. The person with the shortest hair is going to ask the person with the longest hair, when you feel intimidated, how do you feel? Because we've all had an authority figure. Has anybody not had an authority figure? You know, a boss, a husband, a wife, a grandmother, a mother-in-law? An authority figure where you felt intimidated? So you're going to ask that person, when you feel intimidated, how do you feel? And the person with the long hair is going to write down how they feel. Oh. And then in 30 seconds, I'm going to say stop, and then we're going to switch, and then the long-haired person is going to ask the short-haired person the same process. So, okay, ready? Go. Long-haired how you feel, and then write it down.
Not listening to
So who was able to go down 7 feelings?
No, it was this boy.
Anyone able to continue to go down and say when you feel that? How do you feel?
Mm-hmm. No. We got okay. 4 down.
Oh, you went 4 down? Okay. All right. It's okay.
We read the
instruction. And when you feel that, how do you feel? When you feel that, how do you feel? You're right. Okay. I apologize. Ladies and gentlemen, I apologize that I wasn't as clear as I thought I was. Okay, but if I can have your attention, that's more important right now. Okay, so I feel inadequate, not good enough. I feel insecure. Okay, and I also feel that it's all okay because I know that you'll be able to see what I did, and I feel embarrassed that I wasn't clear. Okay, and so what I'd like to do then is just move forward. Okay, and so what I'm going to do is show you if you get on the next page. You will see what I'm going to show you and how to decode. So when I work with my clients, this was a client that I had that was worked at Walt Disney World. And she was a manager, and she was not moving forward in her career. She felt that her boss was obviously in control of where she went. She felt that that he was intimidating, and so she was withdrawing. Her team was not doing well. They had been given notice about things that weren't happening. And she realized that when she would go to a meeting and she was the manager, that somebody, so to speak, under her would be talking about people that she should have been talking about in her team. And she realized that she was afraid, like so many people that I work with, you know, she was afraid that they wouldn't like her, that she might say something that would upset. So she would just get quiet and not share all the information that she had. And so this person had her life in his control. And so we decoded, this is in our first session together, just so you know, and we decoded what was going on with her. So you have that, a space to write, and there's lines, so after you go down, then you see an arrow, then write the next one down. So we started out and I said, well, how do you feel when you're around your boss? And she said, I feel intimidated. And I said, and when you feel that, how do you feel? I have no voice. And when you feel that, how do you feel? I said, powerless. I said, when you feel powerless, how do you feel? She said, I feel hopeless. I said, when you feel hopeless, how do you feel? I feel like giving up. Familiar? Given up. And when you feel like giving up, how do you feel? Angry. So when you feel angry, how do you feel? Just vindictive. Right? Now, when we don't have the emotional intelligence and we get to vindictive, this is when the gun comes out. This is when we scream at our children because they're making us want to get back at them. This is when we have the fight with our spouse. We want to get back at them. And when you feel vindictive, how do you feel? In control. And when you feel in control, how do you feel? Fearful. Fearful. I said, and when you feel fearful, how do you feel? Weak. Weak is what she had run from her whole life. The feelings that are underneath are what are biting us in the proverbial tush. The feeling of weak, she couldn't be weak and be a manager. How could she be weak and be a manager? She couldn't know that she was weak. She had run her whole life because when she was a child, she grew up in a challenging neighborhood. Mom and dad, she didn't feel that they were there for her. She had to be strong. She had to make it to school. She had to walk by herself to school. She couldn't be weak. She couldn't show that vulnerability. She had to be strong. And when we have to do something, what happens is the science is that what you resist persists. What you resist persists. What you fight against, what you don't want to know about yourself, is what is pervasive in you. And so when she felt it, because then you have to feel the feeling. This is the part we all want to skip. You have to feel weak. You have to let yourself grieve and cry, or whatever it is that it takes for you to feel it in that moment so that you can open the space inside of yourselves for the opposite. Because your feelings show up as your best friend to tell you exactly where you are. This is exactly where she was. Exactly. GPS. Here I am. And I said, all right, so now let's see what your feelings will want to awaken you to. Each feeling awakens you. When you, the opposite of intimidated for her was confident. The opposite of no voice, speaking up. The opposite of powerless, motivated. The opposite of helpless, energized. The opposite of giving up, focused, on target, on purpose. The opposite of angry, empowered. The opposite of vindictive. Look at that, trusting. The opposite of vindictive was trusting. She could trust her boss. She could trust herself, more importantly. She could trust herself to speak up to her boss. The opposite of in control, bold. Bold. The opposite of fearful, inspired. So now she didn't go to work feeling depleted, exhausted, like this, because she was so drained. And the opposite of weak is take action. I said, so what are you going to do with this knowledge and awareness? Now what are you going to do? And she said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to have lunch with my boss. I'm going to start having lunch with him and get to know him. I'm going to start to work with my team and do all that I've been planning and procrastinating about and never getting done at home to get my team ready, to get my team to be the one that's going to be a shining star. I'm going to do what I know how to do and do it well. And so that's what she did, is she moved forward. She got energized, inspired, bold, trusting, empowered. And when you can now feel that, you can feel relaxed, confident, on target, on task to be able to move forward with your life. And this is the value of having the courage to look within, to allow yourself to decode exactly what it is that you're running from. Until I allowed myself to feel ordinary, until I allowed myself to feel ordinary, I couldn't move forward in my business. I did not want to be ordinary. I was the youngest of four. I had to always be catching up and acting like I was okay and I could be a part and I could be included. You see, I can be included in the game. I can. But I wasn't included. And it was that I always wanted to pretend I was okay. When I allowed myself to feel ordinary, because why would you work with a coach who's ordinary? Who'd want one? But I had to let myself go there and allow myself to feel ordinary and real and authentic and honest with myself in order to be able to then become extraordinary. But only from there could I do it. And that's what awaits for each one of you to be able to do, to really get this. And this, to me, is evolving EI to the next level. And I would love to have you join with me in sharing this information, because when I do it, this is in 45 minutes at the outside with the client. And you get to the core, and they unlock it, and they leave and they go, oh my God, she got a promotion. Think it was worth it? She was relaxed, happy, at peace. Right? And yes, these feelings, by the way, will come back every day. May not every day, but at some point, until we're under the ground, you're going to feel inadequate, not, you know, hopeless, angry, vindictive. You're going to feel all of these. Enlightenment is not sitting on a mushroom going, ooh, that's not enlightenment. This is enlightenment. This is what we mean by enlightenment, to be enlightened, to be awakened, to allow your feelings to give you the exact information that they have inside, so that you can be all of who you are, stop procrastinating on you, living your life, actualizing who you are, because this is how you kiss procrastination. Goodbye. Because when you know how you feel, you can pick up the phone. When you feel you go to pick up the phone to make follow-up calls and you can't do it, what you do is you say, and how do I feel in this moment? I feel not good enough. Where am I not good enough? You know what? I don't know enough about this guy. Maybe what I could do is go out on the internet. Well, where am I good enough? Well, I can go out on the internet and I can look up this guy's information, and then when I go to call him, I'll feel more confident. I can do that. Well, thank you, not good enough, for showing up today. I just realized I could do that. And you pick up the phone. With marketing, someone said to me, well, why don't you do your marketing, Marty? And I said, because I feel stupid. I'm like, oh, stupid. That's what's been stopping me from doing my marketing. Because I feel stupid when I go to think about marketing, because I'm not good at this and that and all of that. And I went, oh, cool. Now I know this because I feel stupid that I'm not doing my marketing. So where am I bright enough? Where am I bright? What can I do? I can hire somebody, that's where I'm bright. I can hire somebody to be able to do my marketing because it's not my genius, right? So whatever it is, I'll give you one last quick example. I'm on my way to go over to see clients in Orlando, and that board that I carry is my teaching tool. And I'm out in the garage and I'm about to get in the car and I go, I feel naked. That's crazy. How come? That's a stupid feeling. Okay. So I said, I don't know, I'm going to go inside and see what that's about. So I go inside, and there's my board and my easel. And I'm like, it's like I'm naked. If I don't have my tool to teach with, it's like I'm naked, right? So I put it in the car. If I hadn't stopped and listened to that simple feeling, I would have gotten halfway to Orlando, and I could now beat myself up for hours drive to Orlando and be embarrassed in front of my client, not be able to do my job well. And all I had to do was listen. Just listen. Just listen to what your feelings have to offer you. And so when you do, you get the wisdom that your feelings have to offer you, to make you feel fulfilled, nurtured, supported by yourself. This isn't about anyone in your life. This is about you nurturing, supporting, honoring, valuing your talents, your abilities, and your gifts, and the very essence of who you are.